video observation. And for the video, we have started a new center called the Fetic Center, where he brings in doctors, users, students, and professionals who are manufacturers together. So when you get manufacturers, doctors, engineers, and students together, you can come up with innovations of the next world. And he's going to showcase some of the innovations and also take us through some of the products which he's brought over here to show you how we can, just like in an analogy, you see how it's done here, we can do it in any industry. So Sabir, will you please come?
Okay. Yeah, you had a long day, I think, but also I make it, I'm more like commercial break, I suppose, make it more interesting. But from an academic point of view, he mentioned I was from mechanical, so I was thinking my feet is in mechanical, my head is in computer science because I have developed software products, my hands are in metallurgical department because I actually worked in metal casting, foundry industry, and done a lot of consulting projects for them. But my heart, I think, is in IDC.
Yeah, thanks.
Trust you. I mean, end of the day, design is very fulfilling, very satisfying, very interesting. It makes you get up in the morning and makes you go back to sleep with a smile on your face. So I think design is the way. But design is a starting point. We have to make sure that it ends into customers finally. So what I'm going to take you through next 30 minutes or so, a journey. But journey. Also partly because I have worked a lot with MSMEs. In fact, I keep on telling in many fora that we must and we should and we do work for MSMEs. So in that context, I'll put a little bit of manufacturing to start with. Then I'll converge into of course, medical. That's where we are here for. But the focus of today's session is about so-called problem discovery. So I'll show you how we are finding problems to solve in medical domain, and that's going to be slight sub-focus. But we'll end with a couple of maybe two or three nice demonstrations by our team. You can see them in green color here about how we actually picked up some nice problems and we're trying to solve them. We're not gone all the way, but we have some nice stories to tell you there. So today, if you talk about manufacturing, you know, you say styling, you say Europe, if it's low cost, it is China and so on. So we keep thinking, what should India be known for in a world scenario, right? So then after a lot of brainstorming, we said it has to be IT. Okay, but then it's not a mistake. I repeated IT thrice, so I'll explain what three times IT there is. First one, you all know, I mean, it is so prevalent that these days you travel anywhere, and if you're Indian, travel anywhere outside in the world, and if you're an Indian, they recognize you, they say, oh, can you fix my computer? They assume that all Indians are IT savvy people, okay. But that is one image we could change over, and I'm so happy. 20 years back when I was in UK, some kid, I'm talking about a 12-year-old kid, actually asked me, do you really have snakes and tigers and elephants on your roads? I mean, the perception of India in the mind of the Western public was so different. But now it is, we're all IT people, okay? The whole country is IT people now. That is one perception. But second one is what our Prime Minister talked about is about so-called Indian talent. I don't have to explain these slides to you. You don't have a mirror, no problem. I mean, I can, but Jugaad is fixing a problem on the spot. It is not systemic innovation. You can't make a business out of that, right? You can't say, instead of mirror, you use a computer, laptop, camera. You can't do that. It's only, we are great at problem fixing, but we need to talk about systemic innovation. So that brings me to the third IT, okay? And the third IT is what they call as, we have all great ideas. We all wake up with great ideas. Sometimes you say, oh, this idea, this became a guy, became a millionaire, billionaire. I thought about it 10 years back. So what? What did you do about it, okay? So whoever goes to market first and makes money, he is the winner. So we all have ideas. And of course, in IIT, we have so many more faculty and so many more ideas every day. And we are very happy because government gives us money to do research. Fantastic. And we can publish a nice paper, get our promotion, and go back to another idea. That's what most of us do here. Okay? My promotion and my salary is determined by how many papers are published. Okay? On the other side, you real heroes of the country, of course, let me put it in a different way, hero, but not so hero. If you have a successful product, you go on some trip to Singapore or Germany, you see some fantastic kitchen appliance or something like, say, wow, this is great. You get in touch with the guy, you say, okay, let me import shiploads of that. Now, increasingly from China, of course. Import that and maybe do a little bit of assembly, a little bit of packaging, a warehousing, of course, maybe print and put a label and then put a price markup and then you sell it. I'm not blaming you. It is There's a lot of risk involved because there's a lot of investment involved in that. That investment you can do only if it is a successful, tested, proven product. I don't blame you for that. That's great. The issue is, what do we do about the middle side? Okay, how do we take an idea which is, let's say, we're going to show you a couple of things here, which are prototypes, which are working fine. The doctor says, yeah, this seems to be working fine, but how do I take it into hospitals actually? Okay, and that does need what I believe is public-private partnership, because only industry, no, it is too risky for that. And government says, no, we can't put money in private hands. So it has to be a public-private partnership. And I'm going to show you examples of how we did that. But before that, I want to show you one lesson. This lesson I share with professors in IIT and professors in other places, but you will appreciate this. I know you know this, but you will appreciate this. This is called as a 10-30-60 formula. 25 years back, 1990, when I did my first product, which is commercialized and it is sold several licenses and then did doing well, software product, I used to think that if I have built, I have done the research, 60% of the job is done. And someone has to simply just package it, test it a little bit, 30% job. Someone has to simply, 10% job is to just sell it. Okay? What is then selling? Everything is done already. Just go collect the check from the customer. Now I think it is actually the reverse. Doing research, okay, and building a prototype perhaps is only 10% of the job done. Now I'm very clear about it. 30% job actually is in making sure it is well packaged, well designed. You've seen some great examples from the previous speaker. And if you drop it, it should not fall down. There's a proper brochure for that, website for that. The certification, it meets all the standards. Oh, that's a lot of work. That is still 30%. The real effort is in actually building a brand, a company, a team, a sales team, distribution, and making sure that finally the customer signs a check. Oh, that's a difficult job. We have gone through the process. I started a couple of companies, so now I know this is true. So I have actually gone through the entire spectrum of research and development and testing and commercialization. So these are some of the products I've developed in the last 25 years of my career. I'm not going to talk too much. I'm going to show you one slides. The first one is called AutoCast, which is for casting design. Those who are metallurgical or foundry people, or if you're friends in foundry, you can mention that. The second one is called as a Flow Plus, which is very complicated software for looking at the how metal flows and solidifies. It is great for companies who actually want to make defect-free castings. And is developed in collaboration with a CSIR lab in Trivandrum. The third one is called as a tooling design software, AX Tooling, which converts a machined part into a what's called as tooling design. Okay. And we also have set up a world's first cloud-based academy in metal casting called eFoundry. And today we have more than 60,000 visitors from all over the world, which is, to me, is a large figure because it's a very highly specialized field. Okay, 60,000 visitors using 6,000, 8,000 simulations done. It's a cloud-based simulator. The last one I want to show you here, perhaps someone may be interested in this, is that now we have a low-cost 3D, low-cost metal prototyping system. You all have heard about 3D printers, but most of them are plastic printers. You also heard about metal 3D printers, but they are extremely expensive, anywhere from 3 to 5 to 6 crore rupees. Now, 6 crore is quite a lot of money. This is about 1/100th the cost of that, okay, about 6 to 8 lakh rupees. We can now take a CAD model and get you a metal part in almost the same amount of time, about 8 hours for the first part, and subsequent parts just 1 hour, okay, at maybe 2 or 3% of the total of the metal printed cost. So we are now rolling it out as what's called as a SMART. SMART is sustainable metal casting by advanced research and technology. We are rolling it out, and as a big national project, we're putting it in different places, and that will hopefully create a new way of entrepreneurship, because you are empowering, you can put the whole thing in maybe about the size of this table, multiply the width by length. About 10 by 10 feet, you can start off with investment of 10 lakh rupees, and you can start making metal parts. But that's all history. My real focus is about medical here. Okay, so I want to show you a different domain which is crying for attention and is a large number of opportunities available for, especially for MSMEs. Today, India needs all kinds of devices for both for diagnosing, which means you finding out if something is wrong, and for treating the disease, okay, disorder disease. The total value of this is supposed to be more than $5 billion per year, which is about 32,000 crore per year. And right now we are importing more than 70% of that. by value, especially high value items like including CT scan machines, MRI machines, to even for catheters and even, you know, all kinds of even so-called and glucose monitors, all kinds of things are importing these days. What is funny is that a small country like Taiwan, which is really maybe half the size of Kerala, they are having a medical device industry worth almost $1.5 billion, which is by value almost one third the size of India, Indian market. Okay, if they can do it, what is so special about Taiwan that we cannot do it? So actually went there and saw that they, in a hospital, that is a university hospital, the top floor was all occupied by engineers, and doctors would come, put the coat on the table, and then talk to engineers, and they'll do a little bit of CAD and 3D printing and start discussing solutions for that. So actually went there, I talked to the design innovation center, I went to the manufacturer who took the technology from the university, even a dentist who actually using those things to treat the patient. So I saw the entire chain from research to prototyping to development and manufacturing and of course end use in a doctor's clinic. This was for a dental system. So surprisingly, this was last year, 2014. Okay. Surprisingly, exactly 10 years back, I had gone to Tata Memorial Hospital for a similar experience, where I went and saw the surgery on a boy, where they were replacing, instead of amputating the leg, it had bone cancer, the knee joint. Instead of amputating the leg, they would open the leg and then replace that, the natural human joint, bone joint, with a metallic joint. I'll show you in the next slide how it is done. And so this was my first experience out of my lab, out of my office, actually going to real life and seeing what kind of problems are being faced by these surgeons. And eventually we talked to the patients, we looked at what the problems these patients are facing. You can see actually the doctor is able to save the leg of the patient, and you can't even make out which leg is amputated, which leg has a joint, right? This whole thing is, there's no bone, there's a mechanical joint. But eventually some of those joints would start breaking up. So the doctor approached us and said, can you not improve this? Can you apply your engineering stuff and do some research and figure out that? So we actually worked for Lex. 2004 I met him, and we had a project in 2007 until 2011-12. We developed a novel design of what is called as a total knee prosthesis or a tumor knee prosthesis. Unlike arthritic joints, many of our parents or grandparents would have gotten an arthritic joint. That is a very simple implant. This is a mega implant. It's like a huge thing, right? You're replacing virtually the joint and the bone also, as much as that. And we developed a lot of instruments and making sure surgery is done perfectly and all that. We also developed our own machines on, we would test the joint because we want to make sure joints are safe. Okay, so we went through 8 million cycles of the joint moving all the time, and of course the machines used to break down initially, but the joint was safe, and we make sure it has gone through 8 million cycles. And in the whole process, this was over in 2011-2012, then next 2-3 years, wherever I would give this presentation, people would ask, so how many patients have gotten this joint? And it's a very embarrassing answer. We have still, you know. The fact is that we had no manufacturer who would take it forward and manufacturing large numbers and supply to hospitals. As simple as that. So now what we are doing is, because we tried for 2 years and no one came forward, now we've gone back to government and saying, please give us some more money, and we will manufacture ourselves some 100, 200 joints. We'll give it to hospitals free of cost. Of course, the government is giving money, we should give it free of cost. And so some of 5 or 6 hospitals, Ahmedabad, Bangalore, of course Bombay, Delhi, AIMS Delhi for example, they all have agreed to now run the clinical trials and give it to about 100 or 200 patients. Of course, they're all cancer patients, so many of the patients would still die. About 75% only survive in this whole thing. But even if we accumulate enough cases and we can then publish papers, then hopefully manufacturers will come forward, because then they will perceive it as a less risky proposition and they can actually invest money in that. But the positive side is that we learned a lot about how to use our engineering tools, whether it's a CAD or CAM or CAE or 3D printing or of course manufacturing inspection, even software development. We learned how to connect the dots, and that gave us an enormous amount of confidence. So now the area is wide open, okay? You look at the kind of things which have come up in recent times, and all these have come up in the last 5-10 years. If you look at biomaterials, okay, or 3D scanning, okay, or look at low cost sensors or cloud computing or mobile computing, we don't have to say that we are behind the West. These are technologies where you can catch up in no time. You can catch up in 1 year, 2 years' time. Okay. On the other side, there's a huge demand from the population and for surgeons and hospitals saying, we want reusable instruments. Many of the import instruments, they say, you can use it only once. So what doctors do, I mean, and I'm talking about good doctors still, okay? So let's say they operate in Breach Candy Hospital and charge the patient for the cost of the instrument. An instrument may cost maybe 1 lakh, 2 lakh rupees, whatever. Then they would, with permission, of course, take the instrument and give it to some other hospital, or they would go to some other hospital and reuse it another 5 or 10 times, but will not charge the patient that much. So of course, it is, you can say it is not legal as per the company rules, but it's perfectly morally right because that patient otherwise cannot afford that instrument. Okay, so there's a great demand for what you call as multi-use instruments, multi-use devices. Okay, and of course, wide availability and affordability and so on is issues. Problem is, this area requires inputs from multiple domains. Okay, so some of you may be material scientists, some of you may be good at electronics, some of you may be good at design and packaging, and you can put them together. The issue we are facing now, the big problem, big challenge in India is, and I think you'll appreciate that because you're running businesses, is people who can put them all together. We have a great shortage of true engineers in the country who are what we call as knowledge integrators, who can put things together and deliver a solution. Many times we find people, including IIT faculty, who say, no, my specialization is this. I can do only this much. Don't ask me to do all other things. And that doesn't solve the problem. From end user point of view, you need to solve the complete problem. Okay, so what we have done is to set up some kind of a system in IIT Bombay now with four goals. One is, of course, to set up a facility where we can actually do medical device innovation. Then use the facility to develop actually a few medical devices. Also facilitate clinical trials and intellectual property rights and engage with the industry so they actually go forward into manufacturing. And in the process, create a new generation of medical device innovators. So we set up these goals for us. It's a 5-year project. We have completed 1 year now. And in this process, we are connecting the four big dots, hospitals on one side, where we want to define the problem and finally deploy the solution, industry on one side, okay? And hospital, we look at what called immersion. I'll explain that to you in a minute. On the industry, we also want to help them not only in production, but also in what's called as GMP. In medical, GMP is very important. You need to have a certified process. If you don't have certified process and qualified process, you cannot be authorized for manufacturing medical devices. So GMP has to be done properly. And we're working with a lot of institutions. Already we have IIT Bombay, College of Engineering Pune, and NIT Nagpur. You can say top three institutions in the state. We are working together as a network institution, and we are adding up more institutions to bring them into network. And right now we have this, and you can see color coding here, of course. It is, there's some meaning there. I'll figure out that a little later. And we have right now about almost 120, 150 people totally, full-time people, researchers, students, doctors, and faculty members working together. But our greatest resource, of course, is the clinicians, the medical community. We are so extremely fortunate that we have all the time, by some good word of mouth or whatever God's grace, some of the top surgeons coming to our lab and saying, okay, we heard about you, we have a problem, can you solve it for us? Why I said so many times fortunate, because I actually had a chance to interact with the Stanford Biodesign and Harvard Medical School and Johns Hopkins Medical School and MIT Medical. There are other top institutions in the world where medical innovation happens and has been happening for the last 20, 30 years. And when they come to our lab, one of the questions they invariably ask is, so how do you get in touch with doctors? So it was a little interesting for me because why everyone asks the same question? So I asked them back, how do you do that? So they say, yeah, usually we send an email and then we make a phone call and then say, okay, come down at 5:30 or 6:30, and then we go there and we're waiting there. He comes out at 9:30, says, I'm too tired, can you come next week? Yeah, they treat us like medical representatives. I said, okay, we don't seem to have a problem like that, because we have the reverse problem. We have phone calls coming all the time. Today also there was a phone call and said, please sir, please hold on, we have busy for next 5 days and we have a waiting list and doctors have to take appointment from us. I'm joking in a bad way, but it's a good problem to have in the sense that we have so many doctors coming to us that we have a bandwidth problem. Okay, we need more engineers working with us to do that. This is they are top surgeons from Hinduja Hospital, the top knee surgeon, the top laparoscopic, the top neurosurgeon, And this is Manish Agarwal, who is a top ortho-oncologist. I mean, they're coming out together. I mean, their time, I don't know what value of their time is. I think they earn something like 5 to 10 lakh per month, I think, like pilots, okay? So imagine the collective value of the time, you know, in this lab. Plus, Dr. Suresh Deshpande, he's a great laparoscopic and orthopedic surgeon from Kolhapur. He has developed his own robots, voice-controlled robots. I said, really? Yes. And then he opened a box full of instruments and says, Pastor Ravi, and he is so modest about it. He says, Pastor Ravi, these are all very crude instruments. Who made it? No, I made it on my own lathe. I said, you have your own lathe, you are doing. And best part is, I actually went to Kolhapur and saw, I said, how can a doctor make a voice-controlled robot? Okay, come on. That even someone, IIT students also had to think twice about it. But actually showed me and actually controlled the robot. And I said, who wrote the program? He said, I just went into the source, the programming details. I said, you really wrote the program? He said, yes. I said, my goodness. And I understand programming, so I can appreciate what he's saying. He can't fool me. Right? So we have doctors who are perhaps not in the class 12, they couldn't decide which side to go, okay? So, Manish Agarwal, he actually had joined IIT Bombay and then was here for 1 month. Then he got admission in KEM and he went and became a doctor. And Suresh Deshpande had gotten admission, I think, BJTI or something like that. But his father was a gynecologist. He says, nothing doing. You are getting into medical domain only. So he takes his frustration by having a lathe shop and spending all his spare time making those devices. Okay. So we have great people like that, you know, and it's fantastic. But we don't do everything. So I'm coming down to my third part of my talk. How do we identify what we should do? Because medical is a huge domain. What do we do? So what we decide is we'll do only those problems, first of all, where there's a clinical champion. Because we need a doctor right from beginning to end, right? We need to a doctor who will allow us in his OT and allow us to take videotape or video grab the whole thing. If you call him and say, ask him for a feedback, he should come. Or if you say, can you go and talk to your patient, he should allow us to do that. So we need someone walking the path with us all the time. So we need, that's the first rule for us. Second rule is, of course, we need to make sure there's a significant local requirement. India is a big country, but we want to innovate for the bottom of the pyramid, a large number of people, okay? Third, of course, is we should be able to do it. Right now, we cannot develop let's say, MRI machine or a functional MRI machine, which is very high tech. So we are looking at things which we can do with our current R&D capabilities. The third, of course, is, fourth, of course, is we can't be competing with MNCs, right? Medical guys are big, big guys. The top orthopedic company, Stryker, their annual revenue must be more than $10 billion per year. You can multiply, right? into 62 or 6.5 crores, whatever it is, right? So 60,000 crores. The value of that one company is more than the total medical requirement of India, right? Annual, okay? So I can't be competing with them. So what we have done is we are looking at areas where there are no, there are the unmet clinical requirement. Doctor says, I have no solution for this problem. Can you do something? And market size is not that big. But big enough that I can go in, I can market that and hopefully succeed. And our biggest strength is our doctors. People say, how will people accept your devices? But we are working with the top doctors. If the top doctor says, this thing works and I have tried it on 10 patients, 100 patients, his word is law. Okay, that's a gold standard for us. So, as you can see, we have broken down the entire process into three. We actually have a 9-month process. And you talk about three trimesters. And the first trimester we say, we completely spend only on defining the problem. You can say, can we afford the luxury of that? Out of 9 months, I'm spending 3 months in defining problem. I say it is completely worth it. Because often we are solving the wrong problem. Okay? So what we do is, we go to hospitals. Clinical immersion means we actually stay in hospitals. We are talking to doctors and patients and, of course, OT and all that. And, of course, we slowly come up with a problem statement. It's finally a one-line statement, but that one line can take 1 month. Okay? And then slowly start looking at what are competing products, is it feasible to do, and so on. And then the development and the deliver things starts up, which is more engineering stuff and business stuff, which you recognize very easily. So of course, we know the success rate is very low, so we promise the government we'll do 12 devices, but because success rate is actually 1:10, but I've just doubled it here. Because we hope our process is so good that hopefully one in four will succeed, or 1 in 5 will succeed. Okay, so I'll just go through 2-3 slides only, which is, I'll take the first 3 steps because this is your course, it is a need definition, so I'll just run through the three slides of the clinical immersion and statement, perhaps a little bit of feasibility. So how we define a problem? Now this is, I'm talking about for medical domain, but hey, the same thing. It could be a hotel or a hospital, it could be a farm or a factory. It's just you need to observe, okay, and observe it without any prejudice. It needs some training, okay. You need to observe like a videotape. You don't start judging things. You just videotape that and come back and discuss with your team, okay. So what we say is we go to clinician, means all doctors are preferred as clinicians. And of course, before you do that, we can ask him how a heart works. Please, we go and do that much we do study. If it's a heart doctor, we study basic anatomy of that and then go there. Of course, we ask a lot of stupid questions, okay? But you can't ask stupid questions too many times, and not after 1 month. Whatever you want to ask, ask in the first day or first week. And of course, we collect a lot of information from Google and patent search and everything. What are current solutions? What are the even distant solutions, possible competitors? We record diagnosis, treatment, and eventually capture what's called the voice of the customer, which hopefully would have been covered today for you, right? QFD chart and all the stuff, all the tools which are there, we use some of those things. And then is a big thing, and I want to spend 2 minutes here because it's important. Okay? Maybe you're hammered on this point already, right? But let me hammer this point very well. Many times we define a problem and it already contains a solution, okay? And one of the classical thing is like even your, let's say your, when the Wright, before Wright brothers flew, everyone's trying to make a plane, and they would say, let us make a flying machine which flies like a bird. If you keep a solution in the problem itself, that's a disaster. Everyone is trying to make planes which are like bird, which are like lightweight, which are like feathers, which are all kinds of things. They would never fly. And then they had this Lord Kelvin, a great scientist, Royal Society scientist, who said, heavier than air machines will never fly. He made a big statement. So combined with these two, it killed or delayed aviation history by several years. Okay. If only they had defined the problem saying, we want to make a flying machine. Don't say machine which flies like a bird. Now, like a bird is a solution, and that's wrong. Okay. So basically, you need to state the problem very clearly, avoid general statements. It should not point to solutions, and then start listing functional requirements. If it's a plane, you say, okay, I want it to carry so much weight, I should have this much of whatever. I mean, you put those basic specifications. It must fly in sunlight or night or whatever you want to put all those. And don't put a huge list. 5 to 10 is a reasonable thing, is what I feel in my domain. And then, of course, any other solution. This is a very important step, and it can take you time. You can do some initial iteration, go back to customer, in this case hospitals, tell them is it right, go back, refine it, and do it again and again for 1 or 2 months. Doesn't matter, okay? And then you start looking at, of course, feasibility and so on. So now I'll skip these and I'll go ahead a little bit. They're all steps, our 9 or 10 steps of innovation which we teach. In fact, as we speak, we are having a parallel workshop right next door, 21-22, and we have our participants, 11 to 15, many of them are students and doctors who are going through these 10 steps for the next 5 days. So as we speak, in IIT Bombay and NIT Nagpur and College Engineering Pune, we have about 15 teams of people developing devices for various specializations. As you can see, many of them are laparoscopic devices, some are diagnostic, some are rehabilitation, some are orthopedic devices, and so on. Okay. And I'll maybe now call upon Lata, who is here, and she's working with Dr. Asiksha at the Hinduja Hospital, to come and tell a little bit about how she got into the problem. You want to run your slides, or this is good enough? Okay, good. So she'll talk a little bit about how she got into the problem, how she met this doctor, how she delivered solution. And of course, she has a device which she can also show it at the end of that. Then you hand over to Sritam and then Vikas, and then I'll go back at the end. Yeah? You don't need this, right? Yeah, I can run this.
So I'm working as a research associate in Betic Lab, and I've developed a laparoscopic instrument there. It all started with Dr. Asik from Hinduja Hospital, who came up to our lab and he had a problem. Like, he used to have a hook kind of device which he used in the cholecystomy surgery, which is gallbladder removal surgery. This gallbladder is removed because of the presence of gallstones, which occurs due to aging and various habits which we carry on in our process of living. So in order to take that gallbladder out, he used to have a hook which he used to pinch into the, like, hook it into the, anchor it to the gallbladder and attach to the diaphragm wall. But in order to use a small hook, he used to have multiple devices, multiple rods and needles, which he used to insert into the abdomen and then complete the entire surgery. In order to make the surgery less complicated and to reduce the number of instruments, we have developed a simple device, which is called as lapograph, which you can see. It uses a normal hook, which can be made into a simple manufacturing process, which is just rounding of the loop and then sharpening the edges. So 1 to 2 processes of manufacturing the hook itself is reduced. Second is, we are using nylon tags, which are readily available in market, which are going to hook into the device, the organ, and the other end gets locked into the hook. So the second part, which is going to anchor, it is going to go and anchor to the diaphragm wall. So in order to reduce the inventory in the operation theater, the complete set can go in one hand. And the problem, which are the three major problems during the surgery, is like the doctor used to have an extra port for holding the organ, and an assistant was required to hold the organ continuously. So now using this, he can use this instrument to a normal port and an assistant is not required.
So, hi, I'm Sritam. I'm also working as a research assistant at BTIC. So, I'm also working on a laparoscopic instrument. So, let me first tell you what is laparoscopy. Laparoscopic surgery is performed inside the body through small holes, typically 5 mm or 10 mm in diameter. The instrument goes inside the hole and the doctor performs the surgery just by looking at a TV screen. So, as you can see, those are the typical laparoscopic instruments. So imagine how difficult it is for a doctor to perform the surgery, and how difficult it is to coordinate both the hands. So normally what happens is that the instruments that the doctor use can cut a tissue, grasp it, and can rotate it in axial direction. But there are some organs like bowels and gallbladder, of course, where you have to perform this surgery beneath that organ. So it is very difficult to reach that side. So Dr. Suresh Deshpande came to us with the problem that it's very difficult for me to perform a surgery beneath the organ, and I need an assistant to hold the organ or lift the organ, so that I have to turn my hands, and it's very difficult for me to perform the surgery. So what we developed is a multi-degree of freedom laparoscopic instrument, and so I'll show you the instrument. So as you can see, this is a normal laparoscopic instrument. Our instrument can hold a tissue or grasp it, and along with that rotate the organ axially. Plus we have an extra degree of freedom that we can rotate the head in a transverse direction. So in a transverse direction also, we can rotate the head axially, and we can also manipulate the tool. Now, there are some instruments available in the market that have this function. What they do is that, in order to maneuver at an angle, they use wires or flexible parts. That's like Indian jugad only. But when you sterilize the instrument in a heated atmosphere, the wires become slack due to fatigue, and the force transfer is not predictable. Like, the surgeon thinks that he's applying this much force to the organ, but actually he's not applying that much. So it's very difficult for him to get acquainted to that instrument. So now what we have done is that we have moved a step further. Now this is the version 1 of the device. Now in the version 2, we have very good locking mechanisms, and we have now approached to a precision manufacturing manufacturer who is actually making the jaws like exact dimension that is available in the market, and we have taken the sizes of different hands of various doctors, and so the instrument now has become more robust and has a good marketable appeal. So thank you.
Okay, hello, I'm Vikas. I'm a BTech and PhD from IIT Bombay. So I will not take much time. So basically, my innovation story starts from a technological challenge, not from a very specific clinical problem, but a technological challenge given by a surgeon. A surgeon just told me that when he looks at a two-dimensional X-ray image, he can reconstruct a three-dimensional model in his mind. So he gave me a challenge that if he can do that, computer should do that. So I took it as my PhD problem. So I solved the problem during my PhD, and I got that technology. It's called X-ray to 3D. If you can Google it, if you can find it, which converts any two-dimensional X-ray image of a bone into its three-dimensional model. So that's a technology innovation. What we are trying to do now is trying to find exact clinical problem where this technology can be used. So what I'm doing right now is I'm making a tablet-based surgical planning software, which is on not just tablet-based for any platform, but on the cloud. So a surgeon can upload a two-dimensional X-ray image onto that software using anywhere, because it works in a cloud, and it will be converted into a three-dimensional model using the X-ray theory technology. And that model can be used for any kind of surgical planning. So this, because of this planning, the surgery becomes more accurate. So I'm very, very shortly I'm telling you, but there are a lot of other applications using this technology. So now we are incubated at, we're going to incubate at Sign IIT Bombay under the guidance of Professor Ravi. We are having a company, and we are going to get this product very soon in the market. So that's it. Thank you.
Yeah, so you can see Vikas here winning a lot of awards with the President of India, and and he has photos with now, I think, our Prime Minister, Health Minister, I don't know how many ministers. Only thing is, this glory has to be converted again into solid business and take it forward. This is our Secretary of MHRD, who had also visited the IDC and our lab. Lata is showing him. Dr. Anil Kakodkar and Dr. Kalam had visited the VNIT center, the Nagpur center of this VETIC. So we're getting enough exposure in newspaper, which is good, but that is the process. The idea is finally we have to take it out into the real life. And so what we have done is we have actually made a special policy for our medical devices in IIT, where we can share the revenue with not only the institute, but also equally with the doctor who helps us and the researcher or the team of researchers who do that. So that equal sharing of revenue has been made as a special policy for our center, and hopefully this works out. IIT may roll it out for other centers also. But to our own team people, I tell them, and Vikas is a good example, I tell them, okay, what next after winning all the awards, okay, or publishing all the things. So step one, I say, is most preferred one is, you start your own company. And Sign is a society for innovation and entrepreneurship in IIT Bombay, where a lot of students and faculty and others join hands to start companies. There have been, I think, more than 30, 40 companies, I think, in IIT by now. Many of them have made it big, newspaper and news. But that is the first one, because I say that you are the parent, so you know best how to take it forward. So you take it, you start the company, that's option one. If doesn't work out, they say option two is okay, fine. At least you join some other Indian company, because we're talking about Indian companies here, but this is taxpayers' money. So we join some Indian company which is open to taking your technology and taking it forward. And you also join as an employee or a shareholder, and you have innovated that, you know how to take it forward, do that. That's option number two. If you still don't want to do these two things, option three, you're orphaning your technology, but it's fine. You give it back to our center, and we'll find a foster parent who will take it forward, again in Indian industry. But the researcher may go somewhere for greener pastures, but then we make sure that idea can still be taken forward by an Indian company. So in a sense, I'm showing the slide to you here, because if any one of you is interested, or if you have some friends or colleagues or anyone else who is interested in medical domain, please do get in touch with us. I mean, and of course, it's not that IIT Bombay is the only one which is doing that, but because we are doing this, we are now link up with IIT Madras and IIT Delhi and Kanpur and Kharagpur and IAC and many other places where innovation is happening, medical innovation is happening. And so we know those networks, we know those people. So if an area of domain which you're interested in, maybe we already know someone who is working in that area in medical, and we can link you up with that. So I kind of wind up now, and we have a website called betic.in. You can just Google Betic and hopefully you'll get that. Betic IIT Bombay, you'll get that. And we are trying to put everything out there. Our process, our team, our products, everything that can be shared, we are sharing it out. Idea is that industries can use it, other colleges can use that, other centers can be set up like that. So we are open about the whole thing. And as I mentioned to you, right now, as we speak, we are running a parallel session right next door, where we're taking our own team of about 60 selected students from all over the country, selected after a resume and interview. And we will take them through, right now, tomorrow is defining clinical needs. How do you define? We're going to show them a lot of videos of actual surgeries and actual problems and tell them, okay, now you define the problem. And then day three, we will show them how to develop it, prototype that, make a business plan, how do you file a patent. And the fifth day, we are going to ask them to demonstrate their ideas or present their ideas, and we'll select the top ones who will come back and work with us further. Right now, the reason why I'm here and you can't see anyone there is because we have sent them by two buses to two hospitals to actually go and see what happens in a couple of them. One is in, both are in Navi Mumbai, one is D.Y. Patil Hospital, one is MGM Hospital. So right now they are there and they'll be back in another 5-10 minutes, so I need to, anyway I'll close it. I need to take them back and do that. So we hope to select some good innovators from this whole program and offer them positions, fellowships to take those ideas forward. Okay, so what we have been doing and trying to do is to start from the other end. Instead of doing some research in IIT and then going to hospital saying, please see if it's useful. No, we don't do that. We go to them first and say, do you have any problems worth solving? And we'll take it up. So it is a market pull driven innovation here. Of course, then we come into engineering thing, which is development and collaboration for that. What I'm also doing and my team is increasingly doing is we go and talk about this all over the country, all over the world actually, increasingly now. And we tell them what we are doing. We want to attract the next generation of people into this, train them. And our best practices of innovation or even testing or standardization or business planning, we shared with the industry. The idea is that we should now flower many more, maybe 100 new medical companies coming in the next 10 years would be great, who are successfully on a global scale. I mean that, not just at a local scale. But I think potential is there. I see a lot of dots getting connected very fast in medical domain, from government side, from institutional side, from business side, from angel or investment funding side. A lot of interest is being shown into this. In fact, next month we are going to be addressing IIT alumni in California. And we have gotten the best speakers in USA in medical domain, just accepted our invitation to come and speak to us. And we'll be showing them what we're doing in IIT Bombay. And hopefully it'll, sometimes you know that, no? I mean, let me say this. When I did my product initially, my software product, okay? And when I would go to the industry to, let's say, convince them to take it or implement that, they would always compare it with something made in Germany or USA. And one question you're using, so how many licenses you have sold in USA? And if I say that, no, I want to give it to India first, okay? Because it's a highly competitive, it's a highly advantageous software, I would rather give it to India first. It didn't really go too far, okay? So then we said, okay, fine. Sometimes you need to convince the domestic crowd by going outside the world and they appreciate you and then say, okay, oh, USA people are using it, so let's take a look at it. So, you know, that's how psychology is. So we need to do everything possible to finally convince the users that what we have is not only, we are very clear, we are not making cheap versions of existing devices. We are making high quality devices for which there's no other solution and they also happen to be affordable. The affordability is an additional benefit, not the main benefit. So we are very clear about positioning those things. Having said that, these are all games, mind games and also technology games. We don't know what works, what succeeds. So 1 year down the line, maybe I'll tell you more what happened for some of the devices which we have shown you today. Hopefully they'll succeed. Hopefully may not. We have to find some new ways of doing that. But I hope that we'll make some friends here who will come forward, either yourself or your contacts, and tell us what we should do. Thank you very much. We can take any quick 2-3 questions if you wish. I mean, or comments, you're fine.
Any kind of certification or approval process is required for manufacturing?
Yeah, if you want to do it legally, absolutely necessary. First process is that you do mechanical testing in the lab itself and generate a lot of certificates or you can say test data. Biocompatibility of the materials, safety, wear, fatigue, strength of the devices. You put them through some kind of a repetitive loading condition. So that is mechanical testing first. And some material biocompatibility test. And there are international standards for doing that for certain class of devices. Let's say orthopedic implant or a cardiac stent. There are standards which we have to just follow. But after that is the most critical step, where you go to a ethical committee of institute has a committee, and hospitals which are going to try it out on their patients, they have ethical committee. So the committee of doctors and the CEOs who will say, okay, let's give us all the data, show us, tell us that it is really safe. And we also go to comparative studies, compare to something, some other device or solution, this is a better way of doing things, or safer way of doing things, or more efficient way of doing things. So we convince them through a lot of, again, questions and answers and data. Then it goes for actual clinical trials, where you actually recruit a patient, we inform them there is a new device, okay, and we are going to be subjected. But we, of course, convince them, and they, usually it is free, or usually it's some insurance also is there. If something goes wrong, we'll say, okay, don't worry, we'll put you back and in order and whatever. So after that, then you get a, and even for doing that, sometimes depending on the class of risk, your devices which don't enter the body, which is the lowest class of risk, class 1, devices which come in temporary contact with the body, by body I mean not just skin but also internal I'm talking about. So the surgical instrument, you put it temporarily, you take it out again, so class 2. But class 3 is which stays inside the body, it's a stent or implant. So class 3 have the highest standards of those testing and all that. So once you go through all those things and you get permission from the DCGI, Drug Control General of India, who is also in charge of implants and devices, he certifies that, okay, you can go ahead to clinical trials. Then you do that, get all the data back, then you say that it is safe. Then they give permission for you to manufacture. This is a proper scientific legal way of doing things. That's what the world does, and we don't want any shortcuts in that. But for class 1 device, which is doesn't come in contact with the human body, is let's say a rehabilitation device, let's say something for helping the blind, or maybe for let's say external processes. They are easier to do, and you can get those, all these things done. Development can take 1 year, maybe all these things, my guess is at the most 1 more year. So you can be actually in business in 2 to 3 years time. But class 2, class 3 will take more time.
Sir, it was a very nice and informative session for me. We are an industrial design company based in Pune, especially catering to medical industries and medical devices and instruments. So my question is, how do we as a service-based company in industrial design can collaborate with BTEC?
Quick things, I'll tell a couple of things. One is, increasingly we will get in touch with medical, Indian medical manufacturers. We are already doing that. There's one company in Pune called Biorad, which we visited about a couple of weeks back. They are setting up this huge manufacturing facility for doing all kinds of devices. And what I've seen from previous speaker, that design touch, putting not just putting style, which is of course a great perception and value addition, but also re-engineering, making sure it is actually works better, more efficient, and ergonomic, and so on. There's no discussion about it, no doubt about it. But when I say design, also it is not just device itself, but also the entire thing, including the how the product will be used, how it will be packaged, how it will be actually delivered. I think the whole ecosystem is equally important, is what we're slowly thinking. So immediate thing is that as you get in touch with companies, and if you just tell us a little bit more about what you're doing, not maybe not today, but please do come back to us a little bit later. And we can, and if you know someone in Pune needs or help something similar, we can just say, just go and talk to them. We want to be also being acting like a what's called a junction box. I'm now aware that no matter what we have done or what we'll be doing next 5 years, it'll be a micro drop in the ocean of possibilities. So we want to keep a database of and make a lot of friends and say, hey, okay, fine, you both work together, and if you want something we can do at IIT, we'll do it for you.
Also developing some own instruments, medical small instruments, and we might need some help in clinical trials.
So absolutely.
So in that sense, can we get in touch?
You can get in touch. Definitely do get in touch. I'm saying, even outside the room, I'll say, come and get in touch with us. So not just because I'm seeing it here. And not only that, if you know any other medical device companies or medical device design houses, do tell us about it. We want to maybe organize an event focused on medical industry only, but Indian medical companies, and we want to bring in the scientists and designers and material manufacturing, the testing people together. We'll be planning the something like that next year. So just tell us more about who are doing these things. Thank you. Was it interesting to you, this session? I mean, okay. Useful to you? There are always ideas. I mean, my bag has this Swiss plus sign, right? But remember, I'm a casting person. I go to metallurgy foundries all the time. So when I take this bag, they always say, oh, you have doctor's bag. So, you know, what I'm saying is that And I visited medical device manufacturing companies. I don't want to name the company, but when I went to the company, there was a bit of a confusion. They said, take Dr. Ravi, and then they took me, and then they took me to the manufacturing side, and then they said, sir, Dr. Ravi, just stay. This is the most interesting thing you're going to see now. And then what happens, a robot comes out, and the furnace opens, and then the liquid metal is poured into a thing, and then he's looking at my face. I said, I see it every day. I'm a metal casting person, right? I mean. But then I realized, oh my goodness, he assumed that I'm a medical doctor, and for doctors, robot and liquid metal and all that is very interesting. Just like for us, going to a surgical theater and looking at a body from inside, you know, is interesting. So I find that by putting feet in different domains, and I mentioned in the beginning, mechanical and materials and computer science and design and of course medical, life becomes very rich. You get a lot of ideas coming through your brain and also contacts. You mention problems to doctors about some technical problem, and you might find a solution which you never thought about before. So this cross-fertilization really works, and you must try it out. I'm sure you design people will agree with this, but you try that. So I hope some of those things would happen today with this session for you. So anyway, thank you for your attention. I hope you enjoy your stay in IIT Bombay also. Walk around. It's a beautiful time of the year. Enjoy the campus and see you sometime. Thank you.